comrades of the mother body, the ANC, the executive of the Dennis Goldberg branch, you say you're humbled. I feel honoured that you invite me back and back again to talk about serious issues. I'm not a shouter of slogans. I believe in activity rather than just the words. And that was the burden of what you were saying, comrade. It's not enough to talk, we have to do. And that's why we're free. And I do agree with you that international solidarity was tremendously important in our struggle. And if you think of the brilliance of the late O.R. Tambo, who walked the line between East and West in the Cold War time, upholding the independent positions of our liberation movement, you see what brilliance it took, while at the same time building, rebuilding our own organizations inside the country. And it was the international community responding to our struggles internally that really led to the freedom. As our struggle intensified and as the oppression intensified in response to the struggle, so the international solidarity grew. I thought I would add that. And I see there's a quotation there from Nelson Mandela. We know too well that our freedom is incomplete without the freedom of the Palestinians. Nelson Mandela was released, and he used to arrive in London. I was in the ANC office in London, and there was always a protocol issue when he arrived in London because the British government treated him as a VIP visitor, the future president, and he would go to a VIP lounge at the airport, Heathrow Airport, and some of us had to be with him. You've got to have protocol and so on. And on one occasion, I was driving with him from the VIP lounge to his plane. Future presidents don't walk, they get driven and specially treated. And he said that he'd been, this was before we were truly free, he'd been released and proceeded, the negotiations were being prepared and so on. And he said he'd been invited to Israel, what should he do? And I said, comrade, you know, when you're president, you might have to go because this is international diplomatic protocol. But for now, you haven't been to any of the frontline states who bore the brunt of the apartheid destabilization. You haven't been to the Eastern European countries or to Cuba or to the anti-apartheid movement of Britain and America and so on. It would send a wrong message to go to Israel. The Palestinians are our allies. They are oppressed by the same forces that oppress our people. Oh, he said, he didn't go. I am very pleased to say. I have to say, he said, thank you, boy, because I was always boy and he was always Nell. But because I was a child compared with him, you know, just 50-something. And thank you, comrade, for constantly laying claim to the youth and youth activists. I think young people like me are doing not so bad. traveling the world, passing on the lessons we learned from our struggle. And I want to refer also to our Freedom Charter. No, this is quite cold enough. Thank you. Some of the lessons from our Freedom Charter. And Freedom Charter in South Africa was not written by a few intellectuals. It wasn't like a Declaration of Independence in America or something like that. If you remember the history, and you were all there, I know, in the 1950s, but you've read the books and maybe absorbed some of it, we held at least 10,000 meetings all around the country. And we asked people to say what they wanted to see in a free South Africa. And one of the remarkable things that our people said was, we declare for South Africa and the world to know South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white together. What a remarkably generous gesture to the oppressing white minority. Because it said, we're not fighting you because you're white, we're fighting you because of your supremacist policies. In other words, you have a future place if you come to understand the nature of our humanist position that all are equal people. The rest of the charter sets out the clauses. I'll remind you, you stopped at the international clause about peace and settling disputes by peaceful means. That's a hope, always a hope. But there are always times as well when there is the need to take up arms. We took up arms. We took up arms against the apartheid regime because we reckoned that the time had come when we had to deal with a tyranny that was killing our people, not just by the actions of the police. In a rich country, that people should die in the Eastern Cape from starvation, that kids died of starvation, that mothers were breastfeeding for 3, 4, 5 years, the same children, because they had no food to give their children, that half the children were dead by the age of 5 years. That is what apartheid did. But apartheid also brutalized young white South Africans. They made them into soldiers. They made them into soldiers to brutalize our people. But slowly, slowly, in the course of the struggle, people came to understand, young soldiers, that they would no longer occupy the townships because they would not act against their own people. They said, as soldiers, we will fight foreign invaders, but our people are not invaders. Our people need protection. Because we said you have a place in future. What's the point of all this? You asked me to draw lessons. Yes, my name is Goldberg, and therefore I'm Jewish. Jews call me Jewish. Non-Jewish people call me Jewish. I'm a rationalist. The religious part of it's not important to me. I must say I like the chicken soup and I like the cultural things of the diet and so on that my mother created. But I like food of other cultures as well. And we're so rich in it in South Africa. Enriches all our lives. So I want to say to you, because I'm claimed as Jewish, if I say I will not support the, I will not oppose anti-Semitism, then I'm saying that it's okay to be anti-Semitic. So as long as there's anti-Semitism, I have to be Jewish, even though it's not important in my life. In other words, I have a responsibility as a human being to uphold positions of justice and correctness and rightness, just as I did as a white South African who was born here, a first generation South African, could go to school, could go to university, and the kids who were the children of the friends and comrades of my parents in the Communist Party, in the Liberation Movement, couldn't go to university, couldn't study further. Probably some of them went to school. We know half of African kids never went to school. So how could I justify this to myself? I couldn't. And in the same way, as a person is claimed as Jewish, I have to oppose not Jews because they're Jews, but Jews in Israel because of the Zionist policies of their government. So it's the Zionist policies that I oppose. And of course there are Zionist supporters who call me a self-hating Jew, who call me an enemy and so on. And I say, but you see, something like 40% of Jewish Israelis, and you must understand when I talk about Jewish Israelis, I'm implying that they are Palestinian Israelis, which Jewish Israelis don't like to acknowledge. So they understand me immediately. And I say these 40% of Jewish Israelis are opposed to their government's policies. Why they say chicken shit and don't stand up against it, I don't understand. Forgive my diplomatic language. Maybe the threats are greater than we experienced in South Africa. But remember, people died here in South Africa. People were tortured to death. People were hanged. People were extrajudicially murdered. But we fought on. I have to be an opponent of the exclusionist policies of Zionism. But let me say straight away, I have to be opposed to the exclusionary policies of the feudal Arab states of the Middle East as well. This is wrong. It's opposed to humanity. I also have to say that in my judgment, part of the problem of the Palestinian people from the times of the PLO was that the feudal states of the Middle East, the sheikhdoms and the kingdoms and so on, Saudi Arabia and what have you, and the Emirates, was that they would support the Palestinian Liberation Organization to the point where it might achieve being an independent state, parallel to the State of Israel, which is what the UN resolutions of 1947 were about. That second part, the Palestinian state, never came into existence. Partly through their policies, partly when they did agree to the idea of the two-state solution, perhaps it was too late in history and the enmity was so great. But the feudal states could not accept the idea of a secular political Palestinian state who would give support to Palestinian refugees throughout the Middle East, who provided the administrative core, who provided the technicians in the oil fields, and who would then be in a position, maybe, to agitate against the feudal states and the feudal monarchs. Just as happened against King Freddie in Jordan, leading to Black September and the virtual crushing of the PLO all those years ago, you see. So in a way, the call to Arab solidarity in support of the Palestinian people always broke down in the face of who would run their future countries and would the feudal state survive. That's my interpretation. It's a disputed one, but I'm absolutely convinced it's right. Equally, these states were very happy when the PLO was destroyed by Israel. They can do business with Israel. They couldn't, in the future, do business with the Palestinian Liberation Organization. This is the issue. And so, the lesson for me, A, from the Freedom Charter, the first lesson, is that we have to provide hope for members of the oppressing group who are not oppressors. They have to know that in future, they're not all going to be lined up and shot. That's what we did in South Africa. We struggle now to uphold our non-racist. We keep saying South Africa will be, according to our constitution, non-racist, non-sexist. It's even more difficult to achieve the non-sexist part than the non-racist part. But we in the ANC pander to the idea of non-racism when it comes to election times. And then we uphold the rights of the national minorities. And I'm putting coloured and Indian people first and whites last in this issue. This is a reality of our times. And I was told today that there was a young student member who put the pig's head in kosher food in the Woolworths. Well, if you want to alienate your enemy and make them impossible of persuasion, that's the way to do it. But it required just a little reflection. What would happen if somebody put a pig's head in halal food in a butchery? How would they respond? And you need to reflect in your thinking about how would I feel, how would we feel, before you rush into mindless activism. We can teach people how to be activists, but it has to be positive for a positive purpose, not a negative purpose of alienating supporters and making our enemies more and greater enemies. That's the first point. The second point I want to make is that I've spoken at a number of gatherings in South Africa during the occupation of Gaza some years ago, the big invasion, the flattening of cities. And somebody equated what's happening in Israel to apartheid. I agree from what I've read and what I've seen in the videos I've seen, the reports I've heard, that the brutality of the Israeli Zionist regime far exceeds anything the apartheid regime did. It's much more brutal. And so the simple equation is not so easy, but we do know that in doing this, If you have women arrive at a checkpoint wanting to go and give birth to a baby at a clinic or a nursing home, and young Jewish Israeli guards compel her, in effect, to have the baby there. And this is not just one isolated incident, or injured people needing to be rushed to hospital. What sort of people are we making of the dominant group? What inhumanity are we breeding for the future? Within our own society, and our own, you don't agree with me, I'll kill you. No, this is, this is not so far from South Africa. Not so far from KwaZulu-Natal and the opposition between Inkatha and the ANC. As the ANC strength was growing, Inkatha's response was to kill ANC people. And it's still happening. We kill our political enemies, we don't persuade them when we have all the opportunity. These are lessons we have to take for ourselves, as well as trying to point out to others. And I say, after I was released from prison in 1985 and joined the office of the ANC in London, I traveled the world speaking for the ANC at the United Nations, traveling through America, traveling through Canada, through Europe and Scandinavia. And I found very interesting things. You know, we went with a political begging bowl, pleading for support for our struggle against apartheid. But in northern Norway, they're the Lapp people, Eskimos type of people, who live by herding reindeer. And the electricity companies wanted to drive them off the land to build hydroelectric dams for more electricity. And so there would be stories about, you know, these Lapp people, the men are so lazy. They stay home drinking, and the women and children go out herding the reindeer. And in the winter, when it's filled with ice and snow and they have to bring the herds home to look after them and keep them warm, you know, everybody comes home to the villages in the north and crime goes up. These Lapps, they're criminal people. But there were people in the anti-apartheid movement, the Norwegian and Swedish anti-apartheid movement, who said, that sounds like the newspapers in South Africa. And so, you see, it's easy to fight racism in South Africa, but we're doing it here. They defeated the electricity companies in support of the Lapp people. They learned it from us. And I could say, thank you, we can teach, we can put something in your begging bowl from our experience. The same in Canada. The native Canadian people, everybody calls them the Redskins. We're excluded from the economy in reserves. In reservations. They were denied the use of their language in schools, denied their rituals, you know, their headdresses and their moccasins and so on. And people in the Midwest of Canada, the Great Plains of Canada, said, but we oppose this in South Africa, why don't we do something here? Again, the anti-apartheid movement led to the support of the native Canadian people for full human rights. This is solidarity working both ways. I must say I was overjoyed to experience these things and to be able to understand what was happening. And speaking to Canadian mine workers, and they would say, are you talking about South Africa or Canada? Eventually, I was released in 1985, as I told you. My daughter was on a kibbutz. That's what she chose to do. She felt comfortable there. There were South Africans who had started this kibbutz. They were very worried about my daughter because her daddy was in prison. And so they carried out the negotiations for my release with the backing of the ANC and the International Defence and Aid Fund, which would not have done it without the support of the ANC. And so I arrive on this kibbutz to see my daughter. Why did I fly to Israel? Because I didn't want to fly to England on a South African Airways plane, which is South African territory, and maybe I'm paranoid, maybe I believe in conspiracies, I believe maybe there's an apartheid agent on the plane who'll kill me. No, I'm being serious. And I'm then on South African territory, the captain represents South Africa. So at least I fly to Israel because they have an interest in trying to show that they support the South African liberation movement, but leave us alone in dealing with the PLO. That was the what they were doing it for. And I get to Israel and I'm introduced to a lot of people. And they say, tell us about South Africa. And I must describe apartheid. And I describe the laws, the inequality, special laws for African people, different laws for colored people, different laws for Indian people, different laws for whites. This is what constitutes apartheid. And how is this reinforced? Through religious organizations, through the Boy Scout movement or the Afrikaner Voortrekker movement, and so on. And always, somebody in the audience would say, why are you talking about Israel? And I said, but I'm talking about South Africa. So today when people say, why do you call Israel an apartheid state? It's not like South Africa. They're members of parliament, Palestinians, members of the Knesset, and they have equal rights and da-da-da. And I said, well, you see, you don't have to be like South Africa to be an apartheid state. There is a definition in international law through UNESCO, United Nations Education and Social Council, a declaration on apartheid. What constitutes apartheid? Government laws, regulations and administrative policies that distinguish between groups of people on the basis of race or religion. And if you say, well, any Jew from anywhere in the world is welcome in the state of Israel, any Palestinian who's left the country might have a battle getting back inside again. Because they really do want to get rid of Palestinians. So already, straight away, there's a differential. If you think of the fact that Jewish Israelis can build anywhere they like, even across the military demarcation lines where they go and settle illegally, they get upheld by their government and their military. When I say upheld by the military, there have been occasions when the Israeli Supreme Court has said this settlement is illegal, it must be removed, and calls on the army to remove Jewish settlers from Palestinian land, and the army says we won't do it. We will not fire on our own people. So where's the constitutional democratic rights of people? Because we make separate administrative rules. I happen to have studied it pretty carefully because I want to be sure of my facts. And there are authors who are Jewish and students of Zionism who describe the nature of the differential laws, whether in trade union rights, whether in working rights, and whether rights of return, etc. There's no doubt in my mind that this is an apartheid state. Having lived through apartheid in South Africa, and having been pleased to have lived through it and not been sentenced to death, but to life imprisonment, and to be here to see the victory, I cannot allow, in my name, the same kind of oppression to go on. I have to speak out against it. And I have to try and speak out against it in as rational and calm a voice when really I'm very angry about it. I'm angry about the lies. And I like to say, you know, one thing I learned in prison was to be tolerant. And I've become a very tolerant person, except when it comes to intolerance. Then I'm very intolerant about intolerance. When I come across deliberate exclusion of people from the benefits of their wealthy societies, whether on class or race or religious grounds, whatever, I have to speak out. It's part of who talked about our political DNA. This is our history. Let me say, I learned as a 10-year-old, 1943, just a few days ago, 1943. I came home from school and said to my mother and father, my school book says South Africa's a democracy. And that means all grown-ups can vote for their representatives in parliament, and even sit in Parliament if they're elected. And I say, but it's only whites who can vote. There's a bit of things at the edge, but why do they tell me everybody can vote when it's only whites? Why do they lie to me? When you're 10 years old, there's nothing in between. It's true or false, black or white. Yeah? My parents, being communists, explained to me what was happening. Communists tell the truth, by the way. Once you've torn aside the veil and seen through the lies, you can't go back to believing the lies unless you lie to yourself every day about the reality. But we're all brought up, thou shalt not lie. And we do. We do. Big ones and little ones, sometimes they don't matter. Sometimes they do. But lying to yourself is the worst. That is the way to being crazy. And socially crazy. And unable to see fairness and justice and demand it for all people, not just your own. So those are some of the lessons. I have to say, too, that speaking at meetings here in South Africa, almost always they have been called by members of the Muslim community in solidarity with the Palestinians. I did one talk once together with the chair of the Muslim Judicial Council and with Malema Farid Esak. And we each spoke, and the president of the Judicial Council said what he had to say, and Farid Esak made a very good speech, and I made a brilliant speech. Because I'm not bound by religion or irrationality. I can say what I believe. I can speak truth to power. And then came the questions, and they all were directed at me for that reason, that they know what answer they're going to get from the chair of the president of the Judicial Council. They know from me I'll get an honest answer, as honest as I can give. And after about an hour of this, I said, there's something I must say to you that I've observed. We've spoken a whole night long about the oppression of the Palestinian people, and all I've heard from you in the audience is the rights of Muslim Palestinians. What about Christian Palestinians? What about secular Palestinians? Don't they have rights, equal human rights? You have all your rights as Muslims, religious and social rights in South Africa because of our struggle for the Freedom Charter. I expect you to uphold those rights for people elsewhere in the world. Of course, there was no answer, because bigotry, narrowness of thinking is deeply ingrained in people. So when you said earlier, it's a long, hard row, long, hard struggle to overcome these ingrained differences of opinion, it is. It's very difficult to change people's minds, partly because grannies and grandpas, gogos and tata and kulu, when we were young, it was like this. But now the young people are like that and so on and want to go back to the past, except for Tata and Kulu like me. I want to see change. I want to see change. I want to see young people leading the change. I want to see young people seizing the opportunities, may I say, my generation helped to create and others following us, where they can begin to make a better life. And sometimes I must admit, I'm distressed not by the generality of young people who want their iPads and their iPhones. Why not? Why not? Why not enjoy the things that young people everywhere enjoy with an access to technology that our generation never had? Give a 3-year-old an iPhone, takes them 5 minutes, they can use it. I can't. It's too complicated for me. You know that advert for Oreo biscuits? Eh? And the little girl says, when daddy says, can I have some of your biscuits? She says, no. He says, why not? She says it's complicated. Which leads me to something that Muhammad reminded me of earlier in the car today. And that is that part of what the Israeli lobby, pro-Israeli lobby, and the Jewish Board of Deputies and Zionist Federation try to do is to say, well, it's not a simple matter in Israel, it's complicated. Therefore, go and see for yourself and tell the world how well we're doing. It's not complicated, it's very simple. The simplicity is that a dominant group excludes the indigenous people from equal rights, in the real sense of equal rights, within the borders of Israel itself and in the occupied territories in breach of international law. So, you know, the tendency of the Israeli, pro-Israeli lobby is to say, well, in the occupied territories, you can't say we're in breach of international law because it's an occupied territory. But the occupation itself is illegal by their own Supreme Court decisions and their own constitutional positions and certainly the moral positions to take olive groves that are hundreds of years old and uproot the trees, to take an irrigation system that is centuries old and destroy it, and to take the water away from the agricultural livelihood of the indigenous people and make beautiful lakes and marinas and what have you, and trees, nice picnic grounds, very nice, but you destroy the economy of a whole people. We cannot justify that on any grounds. Not in my book, anyway. And the attitude then becomes that Palestinians are less than people. Just as in apartheid years, the attitude was that all people can vote except if you're black, which makes you a non-person. And that's the attitude in Israel today. And this, I'm afraid, you and me and all of us have to oppose. And I think we are not directly involved in an armed struggle in Palestine. But we have a moral duty to protest what is being done to people and to be told, well, it's complicated. It's simple, stop doing it. It's very difficult. I know people, Jews, will say, but we will be overrun. But in the end, in South Africa, our liberation movement persuaded the dominant group that they could no longer continue in the old way. There was no future in it. Literally, no future for them in the old way. And there is the need somehow, I believe, for the Palestine liberation movement, not the PLO, that's gone. And I think the Israelis must curse the day they destroyed it. Because what did they get instead? A much harsher regime in Hamas. I think the need is to say, in your own self-interest, you need to start thinking about how you make it possible to live together. Whether the two-state solution can survive, our government believes it can, the South African government. Many Palestinians think not. What I know is that people have to learn to live together. The most recent example besides ourselves is Northern Ireland, where Protestant and Catholics, in the end, have been forced to live together. There's still outbreaks from time to time, a hankering for more violence and war, but somehow the lid is kept on it by their own people. So it can be done. It can be achieved. We've seen it in recent times. If we set about convincing people of the sensibility of it in their own self-interest. I am excited to see that in the United States, the big brother of the State of Israel, the bad relations between the Obama administration and the Netanyahu government, and the sense of Netanyahu going to America and making a television appeal in which he attacks the President of the United States and gets away with it. That's the power of the Jewish lobby in the United States, backed by their own intelligence sources, the Mossad or whatever their international outfit is. And I have experience of this, if you'll allow me just to take a few minutes. In California, the FBI was prohibited from sitting in and reporting on meetings of the anti-apartheid movement. There's an outfit called the Jewish Defense League in the United States, very right-wing, but will go and attack anybody who attacks a Jew. And when I say attack, I mean attack weapons, all sorts of things, but also blackmail, information provided by the Israeli intelligence services. And so the FBI asked the JDL, Jewish Defense League, to go to anti-apartheid meetings and report on it. They were fully on the side of those opposed to the anti-apartheid movement, in other words, supporting apartheid. I get to Chicago to raise funds for our first election campaign, sent by the ANC to do this. And I'm sent to meet a Jewish ex-South African who's chairman of some organization. And I make the pitch about why you should support the ANC. And I can see he's beginning to be interested. Fellow South African, you know. But there's a little guy sitting in the corner, very quietly, very dark-haired, very tiny. He says, Mr. Goldberg, what's your attitude to Israel? He knows. He's from the Jewish Defense League. And he's going to make damn sure I'm not going to get any money out of them. And so I say, well, you're asking me, and you know my record, you know that I'm opposed, I'm not a Zionist, and I will not support the State of Israel in its policies to the Palestinian people. And in particular, because the State of Israel supported apartheid South Africa and helped kill our people. They supported it militarily, diplomatically, and training in nuclear weapons and rocketry and what have you. So I cannot possibly support it. And this little guy, I'm being polite by calling him a little guy. There are other words I'd like to use, but I'm tolerant. He says, Mr. Goldberg, when you're collecting money, you do need to know your audience and so shape what you have to say. And I said, I'm not going to lie to you to get a few dollars, which you're not going to give me anyway. And he then says, we've invited Nelson Mandela to a rally in Chicago. We'll get 500,000 people here, something like that. And I say, you, a little Jewish organization, think you can invite the future president of South Africa before he's gone officially to the United States to come to a rally in Chicago? How arrogant can you be? I tell you, without me telling him, he won't come because it would be wrong. That's a pretty powerful outfit that can have the in Jewish language, this is called chutzpah. This is called cheek. You can't believe how impertinent it is. The sheer arrogance of it. Those are the things we faced and you face in your struggle against Zionist Israel. Zionist Israel, part of an imperialist camp, oppression of people in terms of control of resources such as petroleum and other minerals. This is what we're up against. Not an easy struggle, comrades. But I do notice that the United States closed its embassy in Cuba, in Paso, Cuba, closed its embassy there, but it had an interest section. They always had some diplomats in Cuba. Because business has to go on, even if it's to exchange prisoners. It sounds funny, but it's true. It was, I think, in the Swiss embassy or something, somebody neutral, but they always had some diplomats there. They might have to complain about Guantanamo Bay or some intrusion in Cuban airspace. And so, you see, you don't just shut an embassy by withdrawing the ambassador but leaving the chargé d'affaires, you send a signal of disapproval. Diplomacy has its own techniques. So think about the subtlety, not the brashness of it. How do you say we disapprove and we're going to oppose you? And I must say that our foreign minister, Mate, what's her name? Mashabanu says, we oppose the state of Israel. Clearly, this is policy. It's a lot to ask of a government to be as blunt as that, you know? It's pretty good going. What I would say about your idea of going to union buildings is that what it does is to give our government leverage and our foreign minister leverage and to say, it's not just my idea, our people are opposed. It gives strength. It was one of my objections to Thabo Mbeki not allowing our trade union movement to protest about policies in Swaziland against the trade union movement there. He wanted internal unity. Had Kasatu been able to mount huge protests, he would have been in a position to say to the Swazi king, stop this, my people are demanding it. Not me, my people. It's about political power and political leverage. So I'd like you to think more refinedly about your strategy. How do we get our government to feel that it can do this because it will have support within South Africa? That's the approach I would take. I'm rambling a bit because it's such a huge subject. Our lessons for the people of Israel and Palestine. In the end, I say the major lesson is that it is possible to overcome huge differences that have been imposed as oppression on our people for hundreds of years. At least in the formal sense, we've achieved that. We haven't really achieved a democratic society in the sense that if you can't afford proper medical care for your children, your democratic right to reality is not yet realized. I'm not saying we're to blame. I'm saying there's a huge legacy of apartheid to overcome, and it's not going to happen overnight. History doesn't work that way. The revolution isn't over. If I can quote Nelson Mandela in his long walk to freedom, on the very last page, he says, to be free, it is not enough to cast off your chains. You must so live your life that you respect and advance the freedom of others. Well, I'm not sure that all our leaders in the ANC do that. I'm not sure that we as a society do that. I'm not sure that all members of the historically oppressed groups do that. It's a long process. But we're getting there. And if you think about the administration of our country, in 1994, we had a civil service that dealt with the needs of 5 million whites and a few million others working around them. And suddenly, we needed a civil service to think of the policies make the plans and implement them for 42 million people overnight. Well, now it's 52 million, but where do you get the civil servants to do it in a country where half the population never went to school, were never allowed to have responsibility, real decision-making responsibility in society? And you know, I have to tell you that as a young professional white civil engineer, I suppose as a younger person, I made 10 decisions, significant ones, every hour, as against people who were denied the responsibility of making decisions that affected other people. So where do you get such a civil service from? You have to build it. You have to train it. And we haven't done it. We appointed people. We had to appoint people who were not trained. And they often made mistakes. But the biggest tragedy for me, is that we've elevated Nelson Mandela not just to Madiba, but to Saint Madiba. And Saint Madiba personally and alone brought us freedom. Nelson Mandela was the savior. In who spoke biblical terms? He was the Messiah. But this demobilizes our people. It says, you've got problems, wait for a new Messiah to come and liberate you. But what was the truth of the role of leadership of Nelson Mandela and Oliver Tambo in particular while we were all in prison? And OR led us to freedom and doesn't get the credit for it. He died just on the eve of liberation, but led us for 30 years. As I said, walking the tightrope in the Cold War, persuading our own people to rebuild and how to rebuild. Didn't do it on his own, he did it collectively, but he was undoubtedly the leader. And Nelson Mandela comes out of prison and makes a speech of praise of O.R. Tambo at a concert at Wembley Stadium in London. I heard it, I was there. You can't believe how moving it was. What a tribute to a comrade in arms. No jealousy. It's our ANC. We are on the brink of victory. The selflessness is so marvelous. And I have to say about my comrades in many of the trade unions, and I'm thinking particularly of DINOSA, the nurses organization, of NAHAWU, of SADTU, the teachers union, all affiliated through COSATU to the ANC. And if you say to them, why don't you do your job properly? There's a country to transform. They say, we're not paid enough. But they praise Madiba for his sacrifice of his life. And I say bluntly, comrades, what are you sacrificing? Who's going to transform our country? You're a teacher. How can you say, I won't spend the whole day teaching? Not all teachers, some teachers. I will not do it because I'm not paid enough. Who's going to? You're a citizen. You're not just a paid worker. Who do you think made the revolution? We weren't paid to make a revolution. We paid, often with our lives, with tens of thousands of years of imprisonment, of people who were tortured, people who were hanged, people who were shot dead. Not money. The commitment to the concept of freedom for ourselves, of the people of Africa, the people of the Middle East, and wherever we can contribute. That, for me, is the lesson we have to learn. And if you say, comrade, we have to transform our country, talk to our teachers. Talk to ourselves. When I see the splits in COSATU over what I believe are often personality clashes and not fundamental issues, I say, what are you doing to our country, comrades? What are you doing? What are you doing about selling buildings at inflated prices or cheap prices? What's the game going on here? We swore we would never allow this kind of thing. In the 1950s and 60s and 70s, trade union officials were never paid more than the highest paid worker they represented. Well, now they're general secretaries and treasurers of multi-million corporations. Seriously. So there's a reason to hold on to the job, not the revolution or the benefit of workers. This is a reality. And if somebody, you know, they would collect the subscriptions from their workers, tickies and sixpences. Do you know what tickies and sixpences were? No. 5 cents and 10 cents or whatever it was. And if any was missing, they'd be fired from their jobs. We demanded integrity. We don't today. We have senior trade union leaders who are appointed to boards because they're trade union leaders. They forget to account for that extra salary. Attend four meetings a year, get paid, what, 10,000 a time, 20,000 a time? It goes into their pockets, not into the union money. They're there ex officio. Why do they take it as salary? What sort of a country are we? I hope I'm not treading on anybody's toes, but if I am, I don't care. Let me wind up and say, I think we have to be clear in our minds that Israel is an apartheid state with separate laws for different groups of people. It's not that it has to be exactly like South Africa. It has to eliminate the differential treatment of people by law, by regulation, and by administrative practice. So when people say, well, you South Africans, you're biased against us, we're not. We're talking international law. Weak international law, but international law. And when it comes to international law, I would like to see those perpetrators of crimes against humanity, the major Western powers, brought before the International Criminal Court. I'm not saying that we should ignore our constitution, as over al-Bashir from Sudan, but I understand why we refuse to arrest him. I object very strongly when the United States condemns us for the shameful treatment of our laws and international law when they're not even members of the International Criminal Court. And when they were charged for laying mines in the harbor at Nicaragua, they said, we won't go to court, we don't recognize it. So they want to uphold international law except when it affects them and tell us what we can and can't do. And as Africans, I think we have the right to say that justice is not blind. Justice is political, and especially in our international community. And when Tony Blair takes his country to war against Iraq because we have to deal with weapons of mass destruction, and it's later shown that these were lies, the reports were lies, he says, I don't care if it was lies, we were right. Nobody says, you're a liar, you've perjured yourself, you should be brought before court and go to prison for it. Think of the people you killed. No, no. United States, Great Britain, France, Germany are still too powerful for that. But the United States can no longer fight its wars on its own. It just can't do it. At last, the United States consults at the United Nations to go into Libya, and then they turn it around, change the rules and so on. But they can't do it on their own because they can't afford it anymore. Because it's no longer the single most powerful economy. China, Japan, India, Western Europe. The share of the Americans in international trade is much less. They're much weaker than they were. So don't give up, comrade. Don't give up. The world's changing. I can't wait that long. I'm 82 years old and I want to see the change. I hope to see it. But it does need action. I'm pleased to hear the vivas and the long lives. I want action, comrades. I want action. I want action. Thank you. Thank you.